Welcome, 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 welcome home. Welcome home, welcome to the 19th hole, where we have we have finished. Where we have finished, where we're done, we're completed. We've completed our considerations. We're already there. This is the heart of all practice. We're already there. The key to the our guru friends is that we don't have to explain anything to them. We don't have to label anything. We don't have to explain our experiencing or label our experiencing. My voice is not so great. I had a coughing fit yesterday. I was in Palo Alto, and the motorcade of the POTUS was about a mile away or so, and helicopters are flying over and security and everything. And as the motorcade passed along, I didn't see it, but it was about a mile away, but we could tell the helicopters up in the air going slowly over the freeway. I started having a coughing fit. I'd be talking to something, have to spit. I was trying to, like, something like stuck in my throat. It was horrible. It went on and on, and I couldn't get rid of it. Never had anything like that. So, you know, like, it's like my, I was not able to express myself. I couldn't talk. I was trying to talk, and the coughing would interrupt the talking. Really bad. A coughing fit. Coughing fit, coughing fit, coughing fit. You know, it's not, it, whatever it was, it wasn't good at all. It was really bad. It just kind of weakened me, and my voice is, I finally got in my vehicle and drove off, and it stopped right away. As soon as I started leaving the area, it stopped. But boy, I didn't like that at all. It's ominous. That's a very ominous portent when something like that happens. I've always been extremely psychic, and so this was something to do. Some stuff is. It's letting us know. But anyway, so I'm trying to bounce back from that. It was unexpected, to say the least. But the gurus, we don't have to explain. Everybody else, I say, well, explain it to me. Label it to me. I mean, echo it to me. Echo it to me. Okay, so now we're getting in to the deeper and deeper and deeper into the heart of it. The core of it, the essential recognitions of it all here, we're already here. We already have seen it all. We already have this feeling. I'm already enlightened. But what I'm doing is I'm still getting caught up in echoing. Okay, but yesterday I experienced. I became aware. It's like, oh yeah. And then I wowed it. So you will become aware as you practice. I'm already here. You become aware that everything else is pretending to not be here. And so you're dropping the pretense of not being where we are, already are. We're not an echo of anything. There's no echoing taking place at all. Okay, this is so amazing. We assume that this entire existence is an echo, a faint echo coming from some other reality. It's not. It's all right here, right now, 100%. There's zero echoing taking place. And I'm just wowing this, going slowly here. We're already here. We're already here. There's no echoing. We don't have to echo anything. Nobody has to echo anything. The assumption that we and all this is just an echo, and then we have to follow the echo back to the source of the echo, is completely false. It's a complete presumption on our part that our imagination is somehow not coming from us, but coming from some other source. And so we keep thinking we're experiencing an echo. And so tracing it back, we think we need to trace it back with labels and words and explanations. So where is this echo coming from? No. Everything is just spontaneously arising in the now. There's no echo taking place at all. Everything is just floating, effortlessly floating in its own intrinsic spaciousness. We're already there. Now, to a guru, you don't have to explain this. That's what they're experiencing. They know this. So it helps greatly to... I had this experience yesterday. I was focusing on Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodra, or one of the youngest Dharma kings. Well, we call it youngest, but more recent and very overlooked and unknown, which I can relate. I think we can all relate to this, a feeling like you're being overlooked and unknown. Everybody knows Jesus. Everyone knows Buddha, you know, kind of thing. But who knows Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodra? Tibetans in the know, they certainly know him. But the world at large is just never, you know, no clue. And so it's like, wow. He's like a historic avatar. He embodies the history of spiritual endeavor, especially Tibetan Buddhism. It's as if all of the great efforts was incarnated in one appearance. All the great historical efforts of Tibetan Buddhism were incarnated in this one appearance. So I said, let's give him his due. Let's put him on the stage. You know, just like St. Jude was overlooked so much, but he's a very profound apostle. Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodra is another one who's extremely overlooked. And I always tend to promote the underdog. Because I feel like an underdog. We all feel like an underdog here, do we not? To delusion. But an underdog doesn't mean something insufficient. Not at all. So I said, it's your day today. I try to do that. It's your day today. He's been showing up big time. In such amazing ways. So yesterday I realized that this spiritual motif that I've had for my whole life, of this, like an orange construction cone, dark orange construction cone, I've used that symbol. I'll keep showing up my dreams so many times with spiritual experiences and dreams of this. And the cone way. I always hear the cone way. Well, I had this amazing experience 2 days ago where in my rearview mirror, after I've had this ordeal and got through the ordeal without any trouble at all, and I was so grateful because I was praying to Jamyang Kenzi Choki Lodra to help me with this. And I got through it and without any trouble. I thought I was going to be in great trouble. And I I was ready to leave the area. I looked in my rearview mirror, and there was this huge construction cone. Almost all I could see was this construction cone in my rearview mirror. And I said, what the heck? And it was on the front of this huge tractor that completely filled up, you know, just this meant very powerful equipment. And they stacked this cone on the front. You know, they put their safety cones someplace, and this happened to be right on the front of it. And it was just filling up my rearview mirror, and it just hit me like lightning. And I said, oh my gosh, this reminds me of something. I said, this reminds me of something. Something's got my back, something very powerful. This, you know, large, you know, heavy duty, was earth-moving tractor, bulldozer, whatever, you know, equipment. It was on the road. It was driving on the road right behind me. I said, wow. Something very, very powerful has my back. And so suddenly it hit me that this cone, I said, wait a minute. Isn't this cone the same shape as the llama hats that I see And who? I said, who's wearing that llama? I said, Jamyan Kensi Choki Lodro, in some of the really famous pictures of him is wearing this hat. Looks like a cone, and it's reddish orange. Okay, it's the red hats that call him, but it's reddish orange. It's exact shape. And then it just struck me that my whole life that these Tibetans have had my back. It symbolizes Tibetan Buddhism, these great Tibetan masters. This cone is like the hats that they wear, especially Jamyan Kensi Choki Lodro, the picture of him. So I say, okay. So the next day, yesterday, I started driving. I had to go somewhere, and the roads was blocked. The road was blocked, and I had to circle back and take a back route through the mountains. One of the main streets is blocked. They're replacing the sewer main. So I took a back road through the mountains, and they were working on that too. And there was all these construction crews digging up the street, and just cones everywhere, orange cones everywhere. And we had to wait for some cars that follow me, and then they took us through all this construction. Wow, was that a trip? Very narrow, windy mountain road with all these huge construction crews and very narrow tolerances and all this big equipment you can barely squeeze by. But cones everywhere, orange cones. I said, oh, this is... And then I finally got through all this construction zone to where I needed to be. And then that suddenly I had this experience that none of this is an echo. There's no echo at all. This is not an echo coming from some other source at all. This is sourced in the now. Everything is sourced in the now completely. I said, oh my gosh, we can experience it this way. And this is this feeling of bliss, of inherent spaciousness. I just recognize this. And I was aware of the potent transmission of Jamyan Kensi Choki Lodro. He was right there, right has my back, right with me. Say, just look at this, yeah. So he really knows his business. And his business is waking us up to the experiencing of reality. But I'll tell you this, there's even more. I'm helpful because I'm ecumenical. He's also super ecumenical, the heart of ecumenical Tibetan Buddhism. He's the heart of it. And he constantly tried to end sectarian strife and say, look, we just label it in different ways, but we're all going to the same place, same realization. So let us stop these petty quibbles. It's hurtful. He said Tibetan Buddhism wouldn't be destroyed from without. It would be destroyed from within by all the sectarianism. And you see that. And now the Tibetan Buddhist monks are becoming hostile and becoming activist and politicalized. And he said that's what would destroy the Dharma, the worms rotting the lion from within. He was very aware of what's going on. So he acted overjoyed to embrace me and meet me, and because he said, here's someone who's super ecumenical and is working towards the same goal. Yeah, and so we're of the same outlook, you know, the same perspective, except that he is of this, you know, vast legacy. He represents this vast legacy. But I have tremendous grounding in the teachings of Jesus too, which are super complementary and actually fill in some areas that are very helpful. So he's got my back. He's letting me know he really has my back and has our backs here. Now, if this is not an echo at all, and it's not, what are we doing? What are we doing? What do we do? What is our position. And it's very simple. It's, we're honoring our creativity. Okay, this is what Jesus tells us. Very helpful perspective from Jesus. All we're really doing here is we're honoring our creativity. Okay. But what I saw yesterday is some depth to this, which is, I believe, very helpful for all of us here. Very helpful. So hear this, hear this, hear this. What we're doing is we're honoring our creativity in the lowest possible way. In the lowest possible way here. Yes, we're honoring our creativity, but we're doing it in the lowest possible way. Believing that this is an echo, that we're coming into this world, that this is an echo we need to, that's being sourced from somewhere else, and but this is all a dream of our own creativity. Sure. So we're here, we're honoring our creativity in producing this dream and interpreting it in the wrong, so that gives us this false interpretation we have. This is the lowest way to believe we're fixated here, to believe that we're bodies, to believe that this is an echo. This is really honoring our creativity, but in the lowest possible way. Now, how do we honor our creativity in the highest possible way? Well, that would be simply knowing reality. And we can't do that here, actually. Jesus says it's not possible to do that here and still remain here. Okay, so we think we're stuck, huh? No. How about honoring our creativity in a medium way? Instead of the lowest, a middle way, a medium way. Let's honor our creativity in a medium way. So I'm kind of mediumly middle, honoring our creativity in sort of a middle way. Not the greatest way of honoring it, and not the lowest way. Not the highest way, not the lowest way. But kind of in between, medium way, I'm on. So, yeah, why not? This is what Jesus tells us. This is our whole goal, is to honor our creativity in a medium way. Not the highest and not in the lowest. So all we're really doing on the path is just changing the way we honor our creativity. That's it. That's all we're doing. Just let this sink in. Super profound, super helpful, is to frame the whole situation in this way. So all these gurus or teachers have been here, what are they doing? They're just honoring creativity in a medium way. So instead of seeing this all as an echo, everything echo, just see it as all floating in its own intrinsic spaciousness. That's honoring creativity in a medium way. Our own creativity. Yes. So we're not judging the fact we're honoring our creativity. We say that's great. So we're not opposed to honoring it in the lowest way, but just... Why try to fixate on that when we can honor it in a medium way? If we really want to honor our creativity, why are we choosing to honor it in the lowest possible way? Continuity fear. So when we see our problem as continuity fear, we stop trying to attach some sort of false meaning to our choice of honoring our creativity in the lowest way. We think there's something necessary or profound. No, it's just continuity fear, that's all. If we didn't have this continuity fear, we would be honoring it in the medium way and ultimately in the highest way. So it's very important to introduce this continuity fear into our understanding, recognition. Then we forgive ourselves. Say, oh, because of this unacknowledged continuity fear, we've been trying to glamorize and glorify honoring creativity in the lowest possible way, as if this was this is where it's at. And this is somehow more profound. It's not more profound. It's just simply honoring in the lowest way. That's all. Which is nothing wrong with that. What's wrong with it is thinking that this is, you know, more profound, greater than honoring it in the highest way. It's not. Not at all. Something in my mouth from Pramda. Hair. Still in there. Can I get it out of there? No. Aha. It's hard to get it out. Right? It's hard to get that out. But I did. It's like a hair on your mouth. And so this honoring our creativity in the lowest possible way is like a hair, this really little piece, little hair that gets on your tongue. And, you know, it sticks to your tongue and you can't quite get it out. You spit and it doesn't come out. It's like that. So you have to keep working at it like I did. So I know I'm going to get it. But I kept thinking I'd get it. And it kept slipping out of my fingers. Perfect analogy for what we're talking about here. We don't have to, so don't try to retch it out. Let's just gently keep trying to get it and you'll get it. There's no profundity at all. No secret profundity to honoring our creativity in the lowest possible way. No secret profundity at all. And we keep saying, no, that this is an echo of something really profound. No, it's not. It's not an echo of anything really profound. And it's only when we accept this fact that we begin to honor our creativity in a medium way. We're recognizing the profundity that's already present. In other words, this is not something that is pointing to something very profound, echoing it. Not at all. The profundity is already here entirely. It's just reality is already here. It's not really profundity, it's just reality, which is beyond labels of profound and not profound. So we're just entering into this recognition here, just the right time, because we have only less than a month now before some shift will happen. Something will happen in the world here, and that this is a pressure on us right now to get in good great spiritual shape. So these new way of framing all this is the new spiritual shape. It's like a new body type. I've gone from like one body type to another body type over the last 10 months. Changed my body type, basically. And, you know, how I move, everything's different. Everything's different now. So it's like a new frame around the picture. And getting in spiritual shape is like we frame the whole situation in a different way. That's what it's really about. So this is how we look at it. This is the framework. And this is a lot of work because it's the way it's been framed previously with the way culture has is it just misleads us. You know, it's really tough. It's very confusing. If you look at the frame, just okay, so you ask somebody in the street, okay, what's spiritual truth, or what's the framework? You know, struggle. I don't know. So we're putting this beautiful frame around for perspective. Like, wow, okay, so all we have to do is honor our creativity in a sort of a middle way. What's the word I want? In a medium intensity honoring of our creativity. Not the highest way, not the lowest way, but just sort of a medium way of honoring our creativity. Just sort of a warm, it's not cold and it's not hot, it's kind of warm. In a warm way, we're honoring our creativity in this sort of warm way, medium way. not too intense, you know, not still not the highest. So we're not aiming for the highest way of honoring our creativity, not at all. Just a sort of halfway, you know, kind of halfway between low and high. Halfway house. That's all. But this brings changes to our functionality, our capacity. We're no longer stuck in trying to honor it in the lowest possible way. So all people are doing is they're trying to honor it in the lowest way. So of course they think their bodies and they're stuck with sensory perception. That's just part of trying to honor our creativity in the lowest possible way. That's it. When we do it in a you know, in between way or middle way, not so high, not so low, then we're not stuck with sensory perception. We're not stuck in believing that we're a body. We can keep a body. We can keep sensory perception still there, but we're seeing as primary. We see everything floating in its own intrinsic spaciousness. Just everything just floating. Everything is, you know, like weightlessly floating. There's no heaviness to anything. Everything seems transparent to its own intrinsic spaciousness. So it has the quality of this beautiful, blissful transparency and floatingness. So that's how we perceive. That's how we honor our creativity. Remember, perception, sensory perception, is just a way of honoring our creativity in the lowest possible way we can think of. We've tried to think of how low can we go in our honoring. How low can we go? And now we're saying, no, let's just kind of back off how low can we go, and let's kind of rest in this sort of a medium depth of honoring our creativity and medium intensity of honoring our creativity. Let's just rest in that for a while. Let's just rest in that for a while. That's all. Very simple. We don't have to explain anything else in any other way. And when we're willing to do this, of course everything's abiding in its own intrinsic spacious. I mean, it's just ludicrous to... I mean, all we could do is be blind to it. But if you try to talk about it, it becomes obvious how ludicrous it is. It's inherently ludicrous to think that anything could ever leave its own intrinsic spaciousness. A bird is flying across the sky. Is it somehow leaving its own intrinsic spaciousness as it flies through the atmosphere? I mean, and we think it's getting some. It's like an echo, and it's traveling towards its own intrinsic spaciousness, but it's not in it. As if motion somehow takes us out of intrinsic spaciousness. This is, you know, just completely absurd. And yet, that's how we honor the lowest way of honoring our creativity is absurdity. And we don't even realize this, that we keep thinking that this is an echo. We need to get somewhere. We need to pursue the evidence. Like, this is evidence of something else. A place where there is no intrinsic spaciousness. And this is like our sensory perception is showing all this evidence. Oh, yeah, this evidence. We need to now follow where this evidence leads us. And this is the New World Order is saying we're pursuing the path, following this path where it leads us. But in the medium intensity way of honoring our creativity, there is no path. There's no need of any path to lead us anywhere. There's no need of any labels to indicate a path that leads somewhere. And so it's just a different style of honoring our creativity. That's all. We don't need to make anything more of it than that, really. Actually, it's very helpful to have a super humble guru, lama guru, because we don't really want to draw too much attention to this in this madhouse right now. It's a lunatic asylum right now. Always has been, but never more so than now. So if you kind of have an unknown teacher, super humble, and you feel, okay, good, I'm not going to be pushed out and on front of the stage and tell everybody, hey, everybody, you know, and I can just be like the humble teacher and just, he did a lot, he's doing a lot, but it's very low key, behind the scenes kind of thing. And gave very little explanations or writing, and just lived it, the presence, and met so many, empowered so many through his presence alone. It was just enough just to be near where he was, or even think of him, and you would get this feeling, everything's okay. It helps us then to simplify and not get caught up in all this labeling of trying to explain, put it into the super complex framework, historical framework of all these various teachings and perspectives and philosophies and everything like that. We just boil it down. No, we're just honoring our creativity with medium intensity instead of the lowest intensity. That's all. That's it. That's all that's going on here. Just honoring of our creativity in one way or another. We just choose the medium intensity. Nothing more than that. Just a simple choice. And here, there's no indication of any path, any pursuit, anything that has to be pursued at all. So that's why we're, you know, peaceful, blissful, relaxed. It's just simply we recognize there is no indication of any need for any pursuit. That comes from the honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. Is you're trying to believe that creativity doesn't even come from reality. It comes from other source, which is non-creative. It's fixated. And so this is why all this perplexity arises. But in honoring creativity in a medium intensity way, there's nothing perplexing arising. So there's nothing you have to do to drive off all these perplexing thoughts and all these, you know, all these. No, it's just not there. That's not part of a medium intensity honoring of creativity. It's just not part of it at all. We didn't do anything to get rid of all this stuff except simply decide, a simple choice. Oh, I think I've decided to honor creativity, my creativity, our creativity, the creativity of spirit, in a medium intensity way. Not the lowest way, not the highest way, but just a medium honoring of creativity. That's it. And by doing that, all the troubles of lower intensity honoring, they simply aren't there. Not part of it. So the whole key is to recognize that we're the ones doing all this. It's our own arrogance that you know, we're responsible. We put ourselves into this. God didn't put us into this at all. God didn't put us here in the world to experience anything, not at all. God didn't make this world for us to experience it, not at all. This is just our own desire to honor our creativity. Now, in knowing, you call it the highest way of honoring our creativity. Actually, technically, you could say we drop it it's both honoring, but really, you could say it's simply being our creativity, knowing our creativity, just being it. So you don't. There's not even any notion of honoring it really at that point. But this completely beyond labels, concepts, words, whatever we could say. So there's no point. We might as well just say it's the highest way of honoring creativity. For our purposes, that works fine. It's not a problem. So we have this very lovely, very simple frame, minimalist frame. You call it a frame of flowers, a beautiful frame of flowers. It's just, you know, there's no sickness, no death, no dying, no birth, no none of this. Nothing has ever happened. This becomes our awareness when we honor creativity with a medium intensity, medium honoring. This is what we become aware of. That's all. It's very simple. But this confusion about echoing, you know, is that's just what keeps us bound to the lowest possible honoring is. Keeps us confused. So this is why we practice. Oh, we're already there. There's no echo. We're already there. Everything is already there. Everything already is where it is. Everything is already what it is, where it is, as it is. Everything is already as it is. No echoing is taking place. This is our perspective. And again, we're not fighting against trying to, you know, the other gives this illusion of presumption of echoing because that's how they want to honor creativity in the lowest way. That's part of it. That's part of the honoring process, what they're doing. So fine. But that's not part of honoring creativity in a medium way. Not at all. It's different, very different. Of course you would expect to be quite different, right, in that way. So we see everything is simply as it is. Now, is there a right or a wrong? Well, since it's all just honoring our creativity, it's not really a right or a wrong, don't put it that way. But there's simply a choice. The perspective, we call delusion, or perspective of echoing, is just a perspective we're using to try and honor our creativity in the lowest possible way. That's all. It's just a device we're using, a belief, a presumption, an arrogance. Just saying, okay, this is what I want to believe. Now, is it true that these are echoed? No, it's not true, but that's okay. We're just creatively trying to find a way to honor our creativity in the lowest possible way. We may be intrigued with this. Like, I wonder just how low I can drop my honoring. Yeah. Let's honor it in the lowest possible way. But that intrigues many. They think, wow, that's, I wonder what that's like. So, we've experienced what that's like. Now we're just saying, okay, so now I'm more intrigued about what is it like to honor it in sort of a medium way? Not too high or low, but what's that like? So we're just simply finding out what that's like. Very simple, isn't it? Just finding out what that's like. Don't need to make a big ado about it. Just find out what that's like. We're more curious about that now. We're not so curious about the other. Been there, done that. It's been, you know, long, weird, weird, very weird, odd, baffling, and such. But that's just part of the experience of honoring creativity in the lowest possible ways. You feel confused, fearful, baffled, all this stuff. That's just how we do it. That's how we honor creativity in the lowest possible way. That's all. And so now, but we're changing. It's like going from an apple to an orange or something, right? It's just a different taste. That's all. We say, okay. Now we're interested. Before we're interested in the taste of echoing. Now we're interested in the taste of no echoing. What's that like? Maybe we're just free to choose that. That's it. Woodpecker on a telephone pole or something. It's, I don't know, didn't that hurt their head? You know, I mean, using their head as a jackhammer, I mean, that doesn't vibrate their head. I mean, maybe that's a symbol for the wow. You know, when we see this, it's like our brain, our mind is vibrating like boom, like a bell, you know, boom, like a woodpecker. We kind of, maybe the woodpecker has to rest for a while. Like, wow, that's just, it's really, I got to get that bug, but that's really wowing me, you know. I don't know. Honoring creativity in the lowest possible way that has all the spirituality that enables us to keep on honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. So they develop a spirituality and teachings and all this stuff which fits right in with low, you know, honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. Fits right in with it. It's all part of that. It's a complete system, a complete perspective. They have God, gods and goddesses, all these teachings. But they craft it, the framework, in such a way that it seems to reinforce, like, yeah, this is it. Oh yeah, it is it. It is honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. That's what it is. So it has this whole paradigm, a matrix of a mental matrix of beliefs that enable us to have this experience. And part of the experience is that we're stuck. And there isn't anything else. And this is just an echo. And, you know, and we were put here against our will or whatever. We have no say in it. We were just, bodies were just created by God and put here. And we don't, you know, all these things. These are just part, that's just part of the trappings, the framework of this perspective. That's all. That's how we stupefy ourselves. We want to see how stupefied can we get. And that's honoring our creativity. How can we use our creativity to stupefy ourselves to the lowest possible way? You know, that's what the world is engaged in right now. And see, how stupefied can we become? Really? That's what they're doing. And you know that very much to be true. And they seem to be having a great deal of fun, kind of, with it. And we know we've been there, and it seems like fun. But there's always this feeling like, I'm really stupefied. Yeah. And I have to keep pursuing. And it's never enough. And I feel like I'm going to not make it. And I'm going to die. And, you know, all this stuff. That's all part of the fun and games of honor our creativity in the lowest way. Just fun and games. But the problem is a continuity fear builds up. And so when you want to stop those fun and games, go to some other fun and games, it's like, whoa, wait a minute. I'm stuck. It feels like I'm stuck. Can't get out. Yeah. Then that's part of the fun and games too, that we're stuck. We're stuck. Honoring creativity in the lowest possible way would be to say we're stuck. Because creativity is never stuck, is it? Actually. But if we're trying to honor our creativity by making it seem as though we're stuck. So we marvel at this. Wow, creativity is amazing. It can even make it seem like we're not creative, that we're stuck. That's extraordinary. But is that really honoring creativity, to say that it's not creative, it's stuck? Is that really honoring creativity? The way that God created us? I mean, if we really want to honor creativity, why not experience all the glory it can give us instead of trying to pretend that it can't give us hardly any? Yeah, right? If you look at it that way, it's like, wow. So we're perspective, we're going to. There's no need for any labels. You don't need everything self-evident. It's self-evident. It's effortlessly self-evident. Everything is as it is. So the mind automatically calms down. And whatever thoughts arise don't disturb anything, actually. But this is just a choice on our part. To have this medium perspective on honoring creativity, it's just a choice we make. We don't have to say it's an attainment. That comes from the lower perspective. Lower perspective keeps giving all these labels of what it means, this, it means this, and no, it doesn't mean that. So when you shift and have this, you say, well, that's so easy. No, I have to make an attainment. As if creativity needs an attainment. A part of honoring in the medium way like this is that you realize that creativity doesn't need any attainments. So it didn't attain this, it chose it. Creativity chooses. We choose. It's a choosing what we want to experience. So we just simply chose this. That's all. But from the lower perspective, they always put it in terms of a path and a realization and attainment and you know, all this. But this is simply part of keeping this feeling of you know, very low honoring of creativity, is to look at it that way. So we drop all of that. You even drop the concept of enlightenment, drop the concept of realization, drop the concept of attainment. None of that is necessary. And you remember probably when you were young, where everything was just simple and easy, and you couldn't understand the world so much as far as what are the people here talking about? I don't really get it. It's like a natural. It's like the natural state, just naturalness. You don't have to struggle and call it some sort of attainment at all. It's ridiculous. So from the lower standpoint, of lowest way of honoring our creativity, there's all this spiritual hierarchy, there's all these attainments and all this stuff. But from the medium way of honoring our creativity, there's not like that at all. Nothing like that. Sure, there are Dharma kings, Dharma princes, and like that, those who are have our backs and helping us to accept this choice decision, helping us stabilize in this and such. Sure, but it's not viewed in the way that the lower honoring creativity would views it at all. So it's not a fulfillment of their view, of the lower view at all. It's not a fulfillment of the lower view in any way. It is not. This is very important. So we shouldn't then, when we have this shift and see everything is floating in its own intrinsic spaciousness, which is wow, we shouldn't then say, well, how do I pour this into the lower viewpoint? Because the lower viewpoint is like people, they have their have cups. But they have them, they have like a cup, begging bowl, fill this up, fill this up. Except the only problem is, it's upside down. They say, fill this up, fill this up, fill this up, and they're honoring their creativity in the lowest possible way, right? By trying to say, you can't do this. This is just an echo. Creativity cannot be truly creative. That's honoring creativity in the lowest possible way, right? By believing that. So fill it up, pour. You can't. It's upside down. How can you fill up a glass? Or it's like a glass with no bottom to it. You pour it in, it just. And it keeps thinking, well, you're not filling me. You're not filling it up. You're not filling me up. That's just the honoring of their creativity in the lowest possible way is feeling unfulfilled, unfilled up, unfulfilled. So as long as they choose that, they will feel unfulfilled. As long as they honor it in that way, of course they're going to feel unfulfilled. Nothing anyone can do about it whatsoever. They're trying to feel unfulfilled. They're using creativity that way, so that's how they feel. So all the talks of God and gurus and grace and everything, and they still feel unfulfilled. It doesn't have any effect on them at all, really. None. It's just they enjoy, pouring, the water of labels into their, cup that's upside down, and they're pouring it and just saying, wow, this is really cool. Yeah, really, huh. Okay, this is really honoring my creativity in the lowest possible way. I'm getting all this great teaching, and it's not getting through to me. And, wow, that's really creative. It's like that. It's really creative. They view their creativity as obfuscation. Like, how can I not get enlightened? How can I avoid, seeing intrinsic spaciousness? And how can I enjoy this? Well, they enjoy it by having all these teachers and teachings say, I really need help. I want to know. And not getting it. Not getting it. That's their honor of creativity in the lowest possible way, is not getting it. But they say, well, but how can we really enjoy it unless we need teachers who teach us, and then we can not get it. And we say, yeah, you see, that's really interesting. We're really honoring our creativity in the lowest possible way by doing that. So that's why you see these Dharma kings, they may not be very well known at all because they're not really playing that game at all. They're not here for that. You got many other spiritual, quote unquote, teachers, and the world is full of pundits and teachers and all this who are playing that game. Earnestly teaching this and this and that and pouring labels and concepts and stuff. And everybody say, oh, yeah. And they're not getting it at all, of course. That's the game. That's how they're honoring their creativity, is by not getting it. Let them pour their own concepts on an upside down bowl. Let them pour their own soup on it. They can do that fine. There's so many ways to do it. We don't have to keep trying to pour the soup in an upside down soup bowl. were already there. The bowl's right side up. Or rather, even more to the point, whether it's right side up or upside down makes no difference in terms of its intrinsic spaciousness, does it not? Right? And what we're seeing is the intrinsic spaciousness, not an echo, but everything as it is. So it doesn't really matter what positioning this bowl seems to be in. Is it ever leaving its perfect abidance in its own intrinsic spaciousness? Is that changing somehow? Because we're moving it around like this? How does that change anything? We keep thinking that we want to find a way to honor our creativity in the lowest possible way. We're fixated. That's part of the fixation. We keep trying. Just let all that trying be what it is. That's fine. But just now we don't, but in this medium perspective, we don't need to try. We don't need to try and turn this bowl in the right way or need to have anything in the right way. It's already in the perfect way. It hasn't left its own, it hasn't left creativity at all. Whereas in the lowest way of honoring creativity, we feel that everything is merely an echo of that's coming from source. We don't know, can't see it, can't experience it, don't know where it is. We're trying to find it, trying to trace it back. And so we don't really experience anything as it is. We take it to be just a faint echo of what we really want to experience, of what's really experienceable. But we need to then evolve and grow and trace it and study and learn and all this kind of to try and find that. What is it an echo of? But how is anything echoing intrinsic spaciousness? How can an echo arise in intrinsic spaciousness? There can't be any echoes at all, actually. We believe that motion is taking us closer, getting us somewhere. So we see motion, we're going somewhere, process. We say, oh, it's moving towards something. And yet, in its own intrinsic beingness, spaciousness, everything is simply, is nothing's ever going anywhere. There's no process of going anywhere taking place at all, or getting anywhere, or getting something. It already has it. Everything already has intrinsic spaciousness. It's not separate from it. It's not separate from it. Nothing is separate. So we're just easing into this here. I got to go on heads up on what's coming from the POTUS going by and experiencing this horrible coughing fit, which drastically interfered with my ability to express myself. And this is what I feel is coming, is there's going to be an extreme crackdown on self-expression, which you might call martial law of some sort, right? Something along those lines, where the feeling that you can just speak up and say what you want to say is gone. Like everything's going to be choked off, and anything, you know, wow, it's hard to fathom in America, land of the free speech, free expression, what this is like. We don't really know what this is like. We're getting a lot of storm clouds, like say, wow, this looks like some kind of nasty storm that's coming. But we don't really know what it's like to feel that you could be arrested simply and on for any reason at all, of just someone, you know, doesn't like your body language, your expression. You know, this is how it gets like that. You know, you're suspect. The way you walk down the street, everybody's looking, okay, is everybody robotic? If someone's not robotic, hey, you know, immediately flagged, red flag. So, yeah, my self-expression was completely stifled. I start talking and then just have to start coughing. Wow. This is really ominous. Very, very ominous. Now, intrinsic spaciousness doesn't need any verbalization to be what it is. Doesn't need expression. Doesn't need any labeling. Doesn't need anything to be what it is. We can be any which way we want. It just so our creativity is unencumbered in terms of we're not losing anything by whatever we're expressing. We're not losing everything as it is. It's always that way. The isness, the beingness is always present. Omnipresent. And again, the lower way of honoring creativity doesn't understand this. It keeps clinging at words and labels and tries to put them together like echoes. Okay, this word's echoing, faint echo, and then we put this faint echo and put these faint echoes together into a sentence, and then this sentence into a paragraph, and this paragraph into a book, and this book seems to be echoing and leading me to something. They're always trying to put stuff together that's leading them somewhere. Whereas in medium honoring of creativity, there's none of that at all. Nothing needs to be constructed or put together. What are we doing? Putting echoes of intrinsic spaciousness together? And no, it's already present. Perfectly present. Always has been. I tried drinking all sorts of fluids, it didn't stop the coughing. I was like, oh, no matter what I did, it didn't stop it. I had to actually leave the area. I had to decide, I'm getting out of here. As soon as I decided I'm getting out of here, it stopped. It just like that. It was like a miracle. Before, nothing I did would stop it. And as soon as I decided, well, time for me to get in the vehicle and get out of here. And as soon as I decided to do that, it just stopped. And that was it. Deciding to get out of here. What does that mean? Well, could mean have various meanings to it, right? As soon as I decided to get out of the mindset of honor creativity in the lowest possible way, you could look at it that way. It just stopped. Or it could mean getting out of a certain area of the world. Leaving that area where totalitarianism has suddenly made its brutal appearance, or as it has throughout history, invariably everywhere it experiences this. It just seems to be a plague. Or it could be leaving this realm, world altogether, going somewhere else. It could mean that too. This is what Jesus apparently has promised us. Promised the world, look, I'll come back and there's another realm I've been preparing for you, and I'll take you there. Because here it's going to be really bad for a while, he says. They're going to really make an all-out effort to maximize the honoring of creativity in the lowest possible way, to somehow max that out. What else can creativity do? If it chooses to do that, it'll try to max it out, of course. Since we're not interested in doing that, there's no real need to hang around. We know that there's absolutely nothing that creativity can do to ever get anything to leave its own intrinsic spaciousness, the intrinsic spaciousness that is present, omnipresent, smoothly omnipresent. There's absolutely nothing creativity can do in that regard. Absolutely nothing. So it doesn't matter what happens here. I mean, these silly games and stuff, it is meaningless. It's just a dance of honoring our creativity is all it is. It's all it is, but it doesn't have any meaning, ultimate meaning at all. It doesn't change ultimate meaning at all. So we're experiencing ultimate meaning, at least in a medium way, but we see that we're experiencing that it's not changeable. So this whole idea that something's going to happen as far as changing our business of being is a truth, is ridiculous. It's absurd. So we don't need to hang around in this absurdist culture, really. So again, as soon as I decided to leave, the coughing stopped. Thank goodness for that. I still feel tired. It was, the coughing was so severe that it was fatiguing my body, you know, and my nerves. I started to get scared because it wouldn't stop. Really bad, not just but you know, really strong, super strong irritation, like I'm almost retching, I'm coughing so strong. Wretched state is coming, a very wretched situation. The POTUS is presumably going to bring about a very wretched situation here. How? It's pretty simple, actually. But again, no matter what happens here, nothing's happening to intrinsic spaciousness at all. No meaning has been derived or changed here whatsoever. There's just, you know, much ado about nothing in terms of, but that's just our honoring of creativity. Hey, it's not doing anything. You know, trying to get it to do something which it can't do. Well, yeah, that's kind of the lowest way of honoring creativity, is trying to get it to do something it can't do. Can't take anything out of spaciousness. Okay. Creativity cannot create outside of spaciousness. But we're honoring the idea that it can. We say, oh, we're really honoring you, creativity, because we're honoring our belief is that you can do something that's impossible. Wow, that's really great. But actually, that's the lowest way of honoring creativity, because then we have to pretend that this is possible. But it's not. So traditional, what we think of traditional teaching, spiritual teaching, is like, we're saying, where is that? Where is that? Where is that? I don't hear that here. I don't hear it. Yeah. Because all of that is based on trying to get creativity to do something it can't do. Do the impossible. And instead of recognizing it's impossible, we insist that, no, it's just very difficult and complex. So we're engaged with all this difficulty and complexity. We think that's honoring creativity, because we're saying, yes, you can, creativity. Yes, you can. Yes, you can. We know you can do this. But, I mean, again, we're honoring creativity in believing it can do something it can't do. I mean, that's the lowest way of honoring creativity, is it not? Really. So we're pretending. We're pretending that, yeah, there is a way. This is an echo. It's an echo of non-spaciousness. thingness and labels and symbols. and conventional in this world is complexity instead of impossibility. But here we realize it's impossible, and we're already on the other side. We're already enlightened. We're already having this medium experience. We're already there. It's already there. It's all. And so, what do we need complexity for? Difficulty. Now that's just the silliness. Difficulty. There's no difficulty or complexity to reality, to spaciousness, intrinsic spaciousness. That's absurd. Because we're trying to get creativity to change that, which it can't. So again, instead of saying it's impossible, we say it's complex. This is the whole, either you believe, you know, that the impossible is complex, or you recognize the impossible is impossible. Those are the two choices we have. That's it. And ultimately, we drop the whole silly notion of trying to do the impossible, or even considering the impossible, whether it's complex or impossible. But we can just look at, well, the impossible is impossible. That's the medium way of honoring creativity. Yeah, the impossible is impossible. And it's very creative, our creativity. By seeing that, that's honoring our creativity. Creativity says, ah, I can function as I was created to function, meaning all perfect creativity. So that's honoring our creativity, by seeing that we are creative. Is that not truly creative? Sure. So that's what we're doing. We're seeing, oh yeah, I don't have to try to do the impossible. Very nice way of honoring our creativity. In fact, I can't. And yet that's very liberating, isn't it? So I won't keep trying to do so and try to lose my creativity. We just keep bringing this up to get familiar. See, this the key is familiarity. The more we talk about this, flip the script on this, just the more relaxed we become. I mean, I'm already feeling more relaxed. First, it's kind of first it's exciting, and then it gets a little tense, and then it gets a little nervous, and we keep going, and then we start relaxing, and then we feel relaxed. This is pretty much the way it goes. In some new endeavor. There's a burst of enthusiasm, right? And it's exciting because it's like, seems like dangerous and not sure what's going to happen. And you feel all pumped up. But after a while, when all that adrenaline wears off, and you feel then kind of get nervous and sort of then get a little irritated and uptight about it. And like, wow. And then you have to stay with it until you start relaxing into it. This is why it's important to have videos or retreats or focus. Your practice, your focus, is to have it in these longer blocks of time. Give yourself opportunity to start relaxing into it. Say, hey, it's not so bad. Yeah. This is the key to it. Really, is familiarity, I've always said, is the key, is decisive. If you don't get familiar with it, you'll stay where you've been before. So when you forge into this new perspective, at first it's very thrilling, exciting. Yeah, wow, this is great. And that carries you into it. And then you start having second thoughts, like, well, wait a minute, I'm not familiar with this. And then you feel kind of the nervousness, tension, uncertainty, all this stuff. And then just keep on, just stay with it. No, okay, this is just a normal reaction, that's all. Eventually, you sort of just feel like, hey, yeah. You won't feel as thrilled as when you started out. No, that doesn't come back, really. Not so much, but you just feel like, you know, I can hang out here. It's okay, hanging out here is okay. It's no big deal. It's like that. It's no big deal. Not a problem. I thought, no, I can hang out here. It's fine. So again, we're not looking for the thrill, but we're just feeling sort of this easement. We start with the thrill. We end with this easement of familiarity. This is how it goes. And if you don't realize that, you'll keep expecting the thrill to remain and get panic when it starts leaving you. What's wrong? Then your whole thing will just turn into all sorts of struggle. So here we understand, full stop on the wow. We focus on this, the process of this, of we start out, and then you know you get the wow, and then you go through this, like, these reactions. We just stay in the wow and let familiarity set in without struggling with it, and then we feel this easement and we say, oh yeah. Yeah, I'm used to this territory. Very similar to going to traveling on vacation or to go someplace never been before. And you're kind of like, wow, you're really alert. It's this thrilling, and this is adventurous. And where's the hotel? You know, the gas station? Or I found a restaurant. Oh, and you come in the restaurant, you're all excited because you're relieved, like, oh, okay, there's a hotel, a place to sleep, place to eat. That's great. But then after a while, you kind of feel like, I don't even know this place at all. It's not familiar to me at all. Nothing's familiar. And then you start getting tired and feeling, oh, this isn't so great. And you have to battle through that. Then maybe the next day, after, you know, 4 or 5 days in the same place, your vacation, you gradually acclimatize yourself to it and get used to it. And then you say, yeah, I like this place. This place is okay. It wasn't as thrilling as I first thought, but it's okay. I've gone to this restaurant 5 times now, and I know the waitresses and the food, and you know, I know the people. I've talked with them a bit and chatted, and they're okay. Food's okay. It's okay. So everything here's okay. It's not thrilling like I thought it might be, but it's okay. It's okay. So it's very much like that. It's just, oh, okay, I can hang out here. I have no hurry to leave. You know, it feels, I'm comfortable. I'll probably stay a few more days. So we have to be aware that this is how it goes. So if we're not aware of this, we just spin our wheels. We just go up and down, up and down, up and down, up, bobbing up and down. It, like, we stay on the surface, like a cork on the surface, just keeps bobbing up and down. We never sink down deeper. And so this gets us nowhere, which is what people in this world are trying to do, is trying to not get it and think that that's fulfillment. That's what they're missing. They're just missing something, which is they want to reject God completely. So they want the teachings of God here so they can reject these teachings and then feel that this is then truly honoring creativity, that's saying, see, we can do the impossible. We're not going to accept the impossibility of it. God told us the impossibility of it, and we rejected it. So this should, you know, this is honoring our creativity. We're so creative, we're going to do the impossible. It gets you nowhere. It gets nobody anywhere. So if you really want to shift your experiencing so that it's not all this misery and suffering of complexity and impossibility and conflict and everything else, egoic suffering, then you have to be aware of this dynamic. And don't be clutching for thrills all the time. And what's wrong? What's wrong? Let it sink in. You have to let it sink in instead of keeping on the superficial level. So this is the wow. Practicing the wow is you give yourself time to let it sink in. Give yourself time. You can't let it sink in a minute or 10 minutes. You can't go through this process of easement in 10 minutes. An hour is sort of a minimum type of time frame, actually, of just, and, you know, we want to do it as fast as possible. But when we cut ourselves off short, we end up slowing ourselves down, which is what the ego, that's what we actually trying to honor creativity in the lowest way. This is what we want. We want to fail. So that's how we fail. We cut it short. So we go from excitement and thrills to just holding on to the wow. And you just say, wow, this is just rocking my expectations so much. An ordeal, it turns into an ordeal, but it's a if you're into it, then you welcome the ordeal. It's a kind of ordeal if you're like a hiker, you're hiking up a mountain or something. It's an ordeal, but you love it. Or if you like to work out, it's an ordeal, but you say, yeah, this is fun. Even though it's tough, I'm enjoying this because I know it's really helping me. But who will put themselves through such an ordeal if they don't believe it's helping them? So this is where the Dharma Kings come in. It's so helpful. Is they showcase to us that this does work. They do have our backs. It will work. It is truly helping us. And so we have faith in them and say, okay, I know this is helping me. Just like a workout, I ask people, you know, how did you do it? And they say, well, I did like this. And I say, oh, okay. So I do the same thing. I said, did it work for you? I said, oh, absolutely, it worked for me. So then I have faith, like, okay, it'll work for me too. But it doesn't just go like a concept, just like I have this concept of being in shape and I'm in shape. It's like, no, it goes kind of slow. And I said, where's all the muscles? I said, oh, they're not really showing up that much. A little bit, you know, but not much, but some. And the strength is certainly showing up. And it doesn't just, it's not just like an concept, and I get the concept, and then there it is. So you do have to have faith that it works. And which is difficult because it seems so slow. But if you're going to work out, you know, basically, you commit to working on it daily. But in the big picture, it may take a while. Nobody wants to commit to too long of a time frame. So don't commit to a long time frame, but just, for me, in the back of my mind, here's how I looked at it. You have to use motivators here, okay, for the path. You have to use motivation because it does seem rather gradual. So without motivation, it's very tough. So what I did, I'm always doing some motivation. There's this time frame of July 24th. I have to be ready by then. I really want to push it by then. So I've been using that for a year. And then I also, or more than a year, and I also used 60th birthday coming up. And I say, the way you are when you're 60 is how you're going to be for the rest of your life. I said, wow. It's kind of like a wedding. You know, if you have a wedding, you can use that as motivation. Just like I'm... You see these women who are way out of shape and just not looking so good. And I see them exercising, and I just like, I'm very just like astonished. I say, there's something is just motivating them to an extreme extent. I mean, no shame. They don't care. You know, the however they look now, in their mind, you know, I want to get married. So so I'm going to do whatever it takes to get married. And, you know, if there's an engagement and they're actually engaged and they're going to be married in a year or whatever, I mean, they will absolutely starve themselves and work out, and you've never seen anybody so motivated, hardly. They want to look great on that wedding day. Because to say, the way I look at my wedding day is the way the rest of my life's going to go. This is the concept they have, the idea they have. Of course, it's more like an idealized image that we want to hold for the rest of our lives, even though we become lazy and out of shape, everything changes and everything's terrible, but we still have that image, that picture, that wedding picture. It's an idealized image that they try to motivate themselves to get through life. This is how people do it, oftentimes. So, it's inspirational to see these women. They're so, I mean, they're doing tough workouts, and I can tell that, you know, they're just committed to it. So be like a young a maiden who's committed to getting married, absolutely committed to it. And this is the level of commitment like this you need to have. So speaking to the women, just imagine how it felt or how it will feel if you're still there. You're looking forward to the marriage, and how are you going to be? What kind of commitment did you feel? Well, you're going to just, you want to get yourself like the best you've ever looked, the best you've ever felt, most confident you've ever been, and every single day you're focused, you're focused, you're focused, you're focused. Take that same kind of focus and turn it to the spiritual path. Like there's this marriage with this new perspective. Not with a person at all, but with a new perspective. So you should be able to channel that commitment to how it felt, the focus. You should be able to bring that to bear on the path. Absolutely. For men, it might be making a team or something like that. Trying to get a job, a really important job. I mean, or various things. Getting in great shape, but it's a little more difficult maybe to come up with something specifically. For women, it's easy. The marriage is, there's no doubt that they go all in, all in. It's amazing, the transformation. You get this woman. It just looks like, wow. Very, no one will ever marry her, whatever. But when the marriage is coming up, and this, a year later, you see him and you said, "What? Is that the same person?" It's just like it completely transformed them, how they look. They drop, 80 pounds. They're like in super. They go to the gym every single day. They're swim, doing swimming. They're getting a super tan. They make sure they get a super tan. They have their hair all made, Go to the salon, have their hair made up really, really beautifully, and they're all made up beautifully. And the clothing they wear, they all can fit into this real beautiful clothing. And it's like, I can't even believe you're the same, the same person. It seemed hardly possible, but they know they can do it because women have been doing that for forever. They're very confident they can do it. And there's all these, there's a whole vast industry of getting women ready for weddings. Vast industry. So it's all set up for us. It's just like, yeah, the gym, sure. You see those yoga girls at the gym. They're just, here, Silicon Valley, it's gold digger central of the whole world. And basically, the women here are mostly just gold diggers. And they just hit it. I mean, they are up early, 6 in the morning, hitting the gym. And it's just all out. It's all out. Because legally, once you get the contract signed, the ring on your finger, you own half the assets of who you're marrying. You just immediately have half ownership of it. So, I mean, that diamond is out there for them here because there's so the nerds here. They're just easy to hook. They're so focused on their work. They're so socially incompetent. They just want. They want someone to help them with that, image of, yeah, I'm competent. And so they're just, the gold diggers will target him and boom, it's very easy. And they own half then of all the future assets right now, assets now, and any future assets too. And typically they divorce them in a while and go after another one. So they get, a couple million or dollars in a house and everything, and then they search, look for someone else who has more money. And do it again, and this is so they're so that the, they're really committed. And you see the commitment, you say, "Wow, I should have even greater commitment on the spiritual path, right? Because that's even that's a much bigger price than some tech slug, right? Much bigger price actually. So why are we not more committed than a gold digger? We should be more committed." Don't let them. They shame us, their commitment. Just take that, the gold digger. They shame us with their commitment. We got to be even more committed, because we're digging for real gold here. We're going to find real unlimited gold. So we have half of unlimitedness. What's that? That's still unlimited, isn't it? And we're not even going to divorce it either, because we say, well, it's unlimited, I can't get any more, so why divorce it, you know, right? I mean, they do everything. They take wine tasting lessons. I mean, seriously, the whole vast industry in the Bay Area for gold diggers, the whole thing revolves around them. How to get cultured. Somebody come from Eastern Europe and Russia and the Asian countries, and you know, they're just hicks. But they're young, you see. They have that on their side, so they can make themselves look young and beautiful. And they take all sorts of cultural classes. So they're always, the weekend's booked. Every minute is booked. They're on wine, they're up in Napa wine tasting today. You know, going to all the different, and they're listening and trying to acquire all the sophistication. So you have all these people who are selling sophistication. This is how you're sophisticated. And they're just spend. They're just trying to, they're shopping. This is what you look like when you're sophisticated. They're going to the right places, the right movies. They're watching the right shows. They're going to the right culture events. Frantically trying to develop this patina of sophistication. Which is what the nerds want. They want to say, hey, my wife is, I have a sophisticated wife. It means I'm a sophisticated guy. Even though they, you know, spending every minute of their life in some cubicle coding, you know. And she'll help me develop, round out my life. So the gold digger says, yeah, today we're going up to the Napa wine tasting. The nerd says, oh really? Oh, okay, great. And yeah, I'm helping you have a full life. You know, you'll have a family and, you know, have a beautiful house, and we'll take these wonderful vacations. Yeah, I can do all that for you. Oh, good, good, good. So that's the way it goes. That's the way it goes. So we have to be even more committed. This is I'm out there with the gold diggers working out, you know, and I'm seeing them. I'm saying, wow, I see them doing something, you know, difficult, just grinding it out. And I said, holy cow. Okay, I better get with it too here. I have to be, you know, spiritually sophisticated, truly, truly know. And they're spiritual gold diggers too, thinking that they can get someone through a relationship. Which is ridiculous, because we're choosing a different way to honor our creativity, which is experiencing intrinsic spaciousness. It's the experiencing of it, of everything is it. So the idea of having a relationship with something that's it is ridiculous. Everything is it. Everything is as it is. Everything is as it is. Everything is as it is. But if you don't have money, if the gold diggers find out you don't have any money, immediately, you don't exist to them. Immediately. And so we kind of need to have that same attitude in terms of if something doesn't have spiritual wisdom, true wisdom, immediately, we're off of that. We're immediately off of it. If someone's just a gold digger, spiritual gold digger, I had to, you know, reject a friend request on Facebook and delete someone because there was all the yoga girls, and they're very good at saying, okay, how do I need to act in order to hook some spiritual teacher or something, and I need to say this and this. Okay, it's all one. Okay, and they're good at this non-dual talk. They go to these non-dual teachers and they're studying. Just like the gold diggers here will go to a chateau in the Napa Valley, one of the vineyards, and they have these big wineries there, sophisticated. They'll go there and they'll go on wine retreats. They'll go on all these retreats or whatever to get sophisticated. And they're, you know, learning all the stuff and how to hold a glass, how to swirl it, how to taste it, how to talk about wine. They take all these classes. It's all about wine here. It's ridiculous. It's so silly. I never even give a thought to wine at all. It doesn't even rise to my interest at all. I might as well be drinking water. It doesn't make any difference to me. And but here it's just, wow, it's so important. So the yoga girls will go to spiritual teachers. They're like going to a wine retreat. And you know, okay, how do I conduct myself? What's the talk here? What's the teacher? How does the teacher want me to talk? They're just taking gold digging lessons. That's all they're really doing. Because they think, well, that's how I can have a happy life, you know, is have a relationship or something. A gold digging relationship. So, yeah, I can make you seem like you're really hip because I can speak to, you know, I'm young, I'm beautiful, I can speak the language and non-dual. So as the teacher says, you know, seems like, oh, they really know what they're talking about. It's the same thing as the Eastern Europeans hooking a tech nerd. It's no different. It's no different. But boy, if you get in the way of these gold diggers, boy, do the daggers come out. Wow. If you put a dent in their image, you know, the Uzis come out. I mean, it's frightening. I mean, there's this beautiful, wonderful maiden who's looking so sweet and attractive. Suddenly, she's like a demon that you know will incinerate you with her fiery breath of hostility. Incinerating attitude is there under the surface. Wow. It's like very shocking. Don't dare put a dent in their image. So you're walking on eggshells here. You know, what can you say, right? How do you tell it like it is here? Oh my gosh, that's horrible. Because, you know, the whole situation here is where you have so much money, you know, attracts flies. You know, this greed and this lust and gold lust, it's like another gold rush is really here. And they are ferociously after this materialism. And it's all about image. And again, any dent in their image, and it's like you've ruined their life. And they look at you like they want to incinerate you. So, of course, you're walking around like, oh, let me be nice to this lady. Let me be nice to this lady. You can't just speak up and say, hey, what are you doing? Your image is ridiculous. You know, who are you fooling? I mean, come on, let's get... No, you can't say that. Unless you want to be targeted for incineration. And I don't know anybody really courts that sort of situation. I can speak up to a guy. I've never spoken up to, in public, like to a strange woman who's a stranger, and just said something to burst the bubble or their image or, hey, come on, because that breaks the patina of like, I'm perfect. They want this image like I'm flawless, I'm perfect in terms of my image. And say, hey, forget about image, you know, don't worry about it. You got to struggle with this, you know, shifting your honoring of creativity. Like what? You know, who are you? You're like a complete idiot. So if you have this wisdom, they view you as you are insane. Really. This is the experience I've had here, living here. I mean, they'll put you in a mental institution and throw away the key if you put a dent in their image. And this is why the yoga girl thing is so dangerous in the world. The more money and more materialism to get, the more severe this becomes. And with this globalization, I mean, and people, everybody's aware of this here, and they're kind of scared of it. They're shocked. You get these women from China coming in here. Wow. Wow. And they get after it. I mean, these Asian women getting after it. Boy, are they acting like they're large and in charge. Like the superwoman on the scene. Flawless superwoman is here. And don't give the impression that they're not the height of sophistication. Holy cow. Like you're supposed to bow and the ground to them. That's part of the image. Like, yeah, everybody's bowing to me. I'm a princess, you know. And if you don't act like they're a princess, I'd look at you like, you know, hey, who the heck do you think you are, buddy? No, I'm not kidding. I'm not exaggerating. And again, the Eastern Europeans and the Russians, holy cow. The Indians, not as much. They tend to be much more, for the most part, much more humble. Well, a lot of times you see the older ones, that just the mothers that come over with the techies, and they're, wow, what a different feeling. Holy cow. They're walking down the streets in their saris, shuffling along. And they're not trying to put on airs or pretending anything. You just feel like so relaxed in that atmosphere. They don't really care about vanity so much, right? It's over for them. but the younger, this place attracts the young crowd, money crowd. Boy, are they into vanity. But it helps point out, it's the vanity of vanities, you know, it helps point it all out. It's a great mirror on the world, actually, of how it really works, the whole world. Greed, money, things, materiality, pursuit. And the yoga girls here are driving more aggressively than the men. This is, so now you understand it. It says, I have to get to my, you know, beauty salon. I have to get to this appointment. That's why these smartphones are constantly booked with appointments. I'm working on my image. And this is the most important thing in the world to them. It's all important. And if you get in their way driving, good grief. You just feel the daggers from them. They're worse than the men. So I can say something to a man and chide him for something. A guy said yesterday, he's at a store. This guy comes in, he's kind of like, I can tell, he's like really bummed out. He's just like, he's feeling too much pressure. He's like, it's such a gorgeous day yesterday. It's just unbelievably nice. And the clerks, there's two women clerks, one of them asked him, says, hi, how are you? How are you today? And he goes, I was like really relaxed. He says, well, not too bad. What he's really trying to say is horrible. But then he's kind of saying, well, I don't really want to tell you horrible. So I'm going to say, well, not too bad. I could tell he's saying it's horrible. So I just decided to say something. I've never done this before. And I said, not too bad. What do you mean? I mean, does that mean that, you know, that it could be really bad for you, that sometimes it's really bad? It's not too bad. I mean, it's bad for you right now, but it's not too bad. Is that what you say? And he goes, yeah. He's really shocked that someone would say something like that, because nobody does that. And he said, yeah. He looks at me, goes, yeah. Yeah, it does get real bad for me. Yeah. That's why I'm saying it's not too bad. It's not quite as bad as it normally is, kind of thing. That's the way he says it. It's not quite as bad as it normally is, right? Is that what you're saying? Yeah, he said, yeah. And then the two ladies, they laughed. Everyone was laughing. And it's like, it was kind of like shocking to everybody that someone would speak up like this. And he was like, who the heck are you? You're like, what? Kind of nervous. But then later on, he kind of turns around, starts talking to the clerks, and he sort of like becomes more conversational. He kind of feels like, hey, it's okay, people accepted me, that, yeah, I'm feeling pretty lousy today, and life's tough, but we had a good laugh about it, and maybe there's some positivity here. So, kind of put some ripples in things. But I don't advise doing that to the yoga girls. I've never been able to do that. So it's a terrible, living here is terrible. Living in the world's terrible. Is it so much about image here? It's so much about image. And of course, image is easily seen through. But the pretense is that nobody can see through my image. The Empress is beautifully attired. And you say, hey, wait, Empress, you don't have any clothes. What do you, you know, you look terrible. And you know, off with your head if you dare say anything like this. But it makes everyone uptight. And there's no better example of than the Silicon Valley of where this uptightness comes from, is image, money, pursuit of money, pursuit of things. Now, if you're not after that, you might, these Eastern Europeans, back in the Eastern Europe, you might say, or Russia, you might, you know, there's no money, no nothing. You might say, hey, you look horrible this morning. You say, yeah, so what? What's it to you? You know, I don't care. And you can be blunt, more direct, and they just kind of shrug. Yeah. But then place a gold mine in front of them, and you say, hey, you look terrible this morning. And suddenly it's like, you know, don't you ever say anything like that to me. I'm a princess. I'm heir to this fortune here. I'm the heiress. Are you kidding me? And you say, hey, heiress, you still have to, you know, go to the bathroom just like everyone else, don't you? You don't dare say that. You've got to treat them like they're some awesome heiress. And then who wants to go around like living like that? It's horrible. But we'd say is we are all awesome heirs and heiresses to intrinsic spaciousness. But then that makes them seem kind of like dumb, like, what are you talking about? And of course, the heiress can't appear to be dumb. She has to appear to be sophisticated. So they only will want these like retreats, this talk, so they can maintain their sophistication all times, and yet pick up this non-dual lingo, like, yeah, okay, so this like this, and okay, I can speak like this. But here, we have to do full stop on the wow, which goes through the shock of recognition. So we're very humble and lowly, and a lot of times we're just kind of like in the shock of it. So we can't put on airs or pretense like we're some great heir or heiress. You can just take the heiress motif, which is the one that really drives the world, is pretending like I'm more than deserving of all your money, because I'm the super heiress, you know. It's just, and you need to recognize this and bestow it upon me. So they can't lose their facade. They can't drop the facade. It's the problem that this attitude has, and it blocks, the yoga girl thing blocks genuine spiritual recognition, because this genuine spiritual recognition is really, you go through this wow, and you're not very functional. You're not optimally functional. The facade is not really there. It's gone. You forget about the facade. What facade? The whole landscape had just shifted on me. I'm like, I don't know what to say. I don't know what to do. Well, does an heiress not know what to say, know what to do? No, they always know what to say and what to do. That's the whole shtick. Is they're never at a loss. They're always poised. Omnipoise, you know, I'm this perfect poise. You're gonna love me because I'm always know what to say. I'm always so witty. I'm always on stage. I'm always bubbling and sparkling. I'm always so beautiful. It's this image they're projecting. But when we experience this, I just experience, wow, there's no echo. There is no, oh my, I can see it without an echo. It's not an echo. There is really no echo at all. We're just presuming it. I was just like, okay, let me keep driving. People might say, what's wrong with you? I don't want to talk. I don't want to say anything. Well, to the heiress, gold digger, that's horrifying. She says, no, I don't want that type of spirituality. You got to teach me some other. So they presume that everybody's just this coach, so image coach, heiress coach. We're not, see? The real teachers are not heiress coaches. Jamyan Kenzie Chogyi Lodo is not an heiress coach. He's not here to coach heiresses, presumptive heiresses, of how to, you know, hook the money. So they want a certain style of teaching. We don't have that here. We have this, you know, get under the hood and bust your knuckles, get greasy and skin your knuckles and sweaty and whew, wow, you know, tired, and we put our, and we're just like, wow. I love wearing dirty clothes because the heiresses, you know, leave me alone. Yeah, look, one look at that, I said, oh, not got anything, that this guy's an idiot. Can't help me. But, you know, we experience the landscape shift, the total shift of our landscape of expectations. and we're just nonplussed. We're just like, wow. We just sit in the wow. We don't immediately say, oh, I need to put my face back on, you know, my facade back on. And I'm bubbly. Oh, that was no problem at all. You know, the air says, nothing's a problem for me. What wow? What are you talking about? I'm wowness itself. I am the wowness. So how can I be wowed? You know, it's like that. I'm wowing everybody else. I don't get wowed. This is the ego. This is material, spiritual materialism. Yoga girl, spiritual materialism. They do the wowing. They're never wowed. But for us, we allow the clarity that dawns within us to wow us. We really allow the wow to hit us, and it's strong. And so we say, I'm tired. I need to sleep. Whereas the Aries, the presumptive Aries, I'm never tired. I'm stressed. What do you mean stressed? Nothing knocks me out. I am the knockout. I'm the one that does the knocking out. So you have this yoga girl spirituality, which is completely at odds with the genuine transmission of it. Totally at odds with it. Can't do both. You cannot maintain your facade 24/7 and take the spirit, genuine spiritual path at all. Because the generous spiritual path is difficult, it's stressful. Shifting our expectations every day is very stressful and difficult. It's doable, but we have to be committed to it. The same way that an heiress is committed to putting their facade on, getting ready for a wedding, we have to be committed, you know, even more so to not to get ready for the true wedding. Which is a different, you know, which is even more, you know, soup is ready for this profound vision, guru vision. Really, we're getting ready for profound guru vision. Absolutely, we are. And so we're doing the tough, dirty work that has to be done for that. We're hot rodding our car, and you got to get under the hood to do that. You're not taking a little dust rag and dusting the steering wheels. Oh, that's good. I don't want to really do anything difficult. No, you're in there doing the welding, you know, the welding work and the just hammering out stuff and, you know, just doing all, working with the wrenches. I mean, you're just, you know, all the tough, sweaty, difficult work. That's what we have to do. You want respect? Well, who do I respect? Like a gender-sharing children, a woman here, great Dakini. You know, she did the work. She didn't worry about her facade at all. And you could tell instantly, just wow, instant respect. There's a real yogin right there. She's a real yogin. A real yogini, a real yogin. Impacts you. Wow. She went after the truth the way that most women go after a wedding and gold digging, you know. She went after the truth. With even more commitment, and forget about facade, you know, forget about it. Her face, you know, tells her, oh, you're just face is, she's like just wowing, wow. You can see that it's been through a lot of wow, just. It's a different look. Rarely get that look here in the world, especially from women. Is it's understandable because, you know, having the children, they feel they need to get a surplus, they need to have some help. But still, I don't. Oh, she didn't have children. No. She just said, "I'll put my focus on truth, and come what may, I'm not going to let anything take my focus away from that." Just that. It's a commitment. It's like the same thing that you remember getting ready for a wedding. Say, I'm going to get married. And nothing is going to take my focus away from that. Nothing. So the same way the gold digger just absolutely excludes anything that gets in their way, push. Well, we absolutely exclude everything that gets in our way. It means we push the gold diggers aside. We push the image seekers aside. We push all this aside. Just, you know, no, get out of my way. I'm not going to give you the time of day. You have to have that sort of commitment, very intense commitment. Be desperate, right? You don't think the women getting ready for their wedding are desperate? Of course they're desperate, because they realize, wow, I'm so many flaws in my personality, appearance, everything, but I got to put on this image that just seems like I'm flawless. So they're very desperate. But that desperation drives them, doesn't it? So we need to have a similar desperation, a very strong desperation. It's very helpful. Very helpful. The difference is, you know, the wedding happens in a year. For us, I've been desperate, you know, my whole life. This is a longer preparation period for this wedding. Being wedded to a medium honoring of creativity. It seems like there's, you know, more preparation needed. So you have to be a marathoner, actually. You have to be a marathoner. Every day you get up and run another leg of the marathon. Every day you get up and run another leg of the marathon. This is how it is. But that desperation and that commitment, I've got to get this marriage. I've got to get this marriage of guru vision. I've got to get guru vision. I have to get guru vision. I have to get guru vision. This is a burning desperation within you. Let that desperation burn there. This is great. I have to get guru vision. I'm finished with the other. I'm finished with the other. There's nothing more I need to do or want to do with honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. Seeking that, what's the lowest possible way to honor creativity? Okay, I've done that, been there, done that. It's enough of that. I got to get guru vision. So I asked Jamyang, I ask you for guru vision. Make it happen. Make it happen. And speaking to Jamyang, I'm speaking to Longchenpa too, because there's extremely close connection there. He embodies, he's sort of the embodiment of all the tradition to Tibetan Buddhism, Dzogchen tradition, and, you know, all of it. He embodies it all. You know, it's all there. It's all there. The overall commitment is there. He said, oh, it's a commitment. And Jamyang Kenshi Chokaloda, you feel the commitment. You feel the commitment. And it's all about commitment. He's committed. You feel the commitment. He's committed to guru vision. No doubt about it. He just wow. He's not committed to anything else, really. No, full commitment. So make it happen. Guru vision, make it happen. So just like a gold digger go to a wine expert and learn about wine, we go to a guru vision expert and get the feel of it, you know, really get all the everything we need. So again, be desperate. Get up in the morning. I got to run this next leg of the marathon here. I've got to get more familiar with guru vision. I have to. It's like that. Be desperate. Be committed. And our preparation is to let the facade down. Allow the wow in. That's our commitment. So feel the shock. If you're trying to just have an image, superficial image, you this will frighten you and panic you. Say no. This is I don't look like I'm on stage. I got like I'm a diva. I got to play the diva. So they don't want any concern or shock or anything registered. They want to appear to be this super happy, bubbly diva. I'm gonna make your life so happy. Can't believe I'm just happiness itself. And here we are, like frowning. Like wow, this is I just so profound. I'm speechless. Speechless. I don't want to take any action at all. I don't want to do anything. I'm speechless. Well, you certainly don't look like a party girl, do you, when you do this? That is for sure. Not the life of the party at all. A lot of times, I just want to wander into some corner or someplace to sit down and just get away from it. I feel so shocked. Wow, I'm just seeing through all of this. So shocking. It's amazing. This is like that. Don't be around anyone that tries to cheer you up in a image way. Sure, there's a different way to do it. Reassure you. Yeah. Yes. You're in the wow. Yes. You drop the facade. Yes. So you could still feel like this feeling of super confidence that this is great to drop the facade like this. Yeah. Of course, problem with gold diggers is they want men to be idiots. Last thing they want is any sort of true recognition. No, they want them all to be idiots. Successful idiots. They want them to believe there's nothing beyond image. The image is everything. And we're just selling and buying and selling image in this world, aren't we? Image is everything, yeah. But, so... So always be willing to be in this wow mode. This is what causes these insights to arise. Because you say, that's okay. Yeah, this is going to knock me out. That's okay. I'm ready for it to be knocked out. Oh yeah, but Prince Charming may who knows, Prince Charming might be passing me by. If you're looking for Prince Charming, so any moment Prince Charming could show up. I don't dare be knocked out right now. Maybe later I'll be knocked out. But what you got to say is, hey, Prince Charming, if you're really Prince Charming, that you'll have to wait a little while. I'm in the wow right now. Whatever is really worth having is already here. Okay, whatever is really worth having is already here and can never leave you. So, don't wait for Prince Charming. Let yourself experience the wow, or Princess Charming. Don't wait for Prince Charming or Princess Charming. Feel the wow. Just be knocked out by what you're doing today. Be knocked out by it in terms of just guru vision. Yeah. I'm really tuning into it. I'm really tuning into guru vision. And this is extraordinary. It's so wow. Be knocked out by it and then just tell yourself the real Prince Charming or Princess Charming is actually intrinsic, the vision, guru vision. That's what it is. And guru vision's already here. It's always here. So it's in not seeking it that I find it. It's in not waiting for it that I experience it. How are we doing here? Okay. 19th hole, welcome home. Welcome home to the 19th hole. Guru vision. Guru vision. We're no longer struggling with those 18 holes. Difficulty of all that stuff. No. We're now in the ease and the easement of it all. It's done. It's behind us. We don't have to go through all the treacherous. I gotta hit this drive. Oh no. I haven't played golf in a long time. The less I play, the better I get. In my mind, at least. There's no scars. The scar tissue is, disappearing. As soon as I start thinking about it, then I start getting nervous. I said, "Oh gosh, I gotta hit this fairway. I gotta hit it. What? If I don't, I'm going out of bounds. What? Oh my gosh. It's just like treachery everywhere." At least the difficult one courses are the resort courses. They make it look dangerous, but they actually make a simple layout, so you make it feel like, oh, I'm doing pretty good here. I have to come back to this course. They make it called a resort course. There's ways of tricking it up, so it plays a lot easier than it looks. But there's some courses they don't do that, and they try to make it play as difficult as possible. You're glad to get to the 19th hole, then. Let me just have a sandwich here. And, whew, I survived. I'm happy right now not playing golf. We got to. The goal is guru vision, which is just a medium honoring of our creativity. Medium intensity way of honoring our creativity. Guru vision, that's what it is. That's what it is. We don't need to make anything more of it than that. It's just, that's what it is. All this mystique, is just nonsense, actually. There's so much historical mystique about spirituality, all this nonsense. It's all nonsense. Forget about it. It's all nonsense. It's just guru vision. And it's all it really is a medium intensity of honoring our creativity, where we're able to feel intrinsic spaciousness is everywhere, that everything is as it is. That's it. It's just guru vision. That's it. And there aren't any pathways to it, except wowing your own clarity that arises. One way or another, your clarity arises, right? whatever you do, the point is that the clarity arises, and then you have to wow the clarity. That's it. I don't care. Again, if you spend all day standing on your head, what's the purpose of that if no clarity arises? What's the purpose of any practice at all if no clarity arises from it? It's a waste of time. It's ridiculous. I don't care if you're chanting the, you know, Om Mani Padme Om, if no clarity arises, it's just ridiculous. So the real issue is, what do you do when clarity arises? And you have to wow it. That's the whole key to it all. You have to drop the facade of success. Understand this is success, but temporarily I'm knocked out, which is great. And have the faith and patience to go through this and just stick with it and don't struggle with it. Don't try to spiritualize concepts. Just allow yourself to feel it and stick with it. So that's the whole key to success. Again, it doesn't matter what your spiritual practices are. And there's millions of different ones. Okay. Again, if clarity doesn't arise and dawn upon you, if the clarity you're getting dawning of guru vision in some way, the clarity arises. If that doesn't happen, you're just spinning your wheels. So why even talk about it? And if you're willing to wow what arises, then you're just driving down the road, walking down the road, sitting in your room, and anything at all, you just say, hey, I can look at it this way. Boom. Super clarity arises, and then you have to wow this. So you don't have to be doing all these various different exercises. The key is your willingness to wow it and be knocked out and drop your facade of sophistication and impressing people, etc. And allow yourself to just, wow, this just really hammered me, man. I've got the hammer. This dawning of guru vision just hammered me. My expectations are just up in smoke. I mean, it's just, wow. And you may just kind of be dumbfounded, right? Let yourself be dumbfounded. Positively dumbfounded. That's super positivity. Let yourself be positively dumbfounded in a great way, shocked in a great way, shocked from the wonderfulness of it. Wow. This is the whole key to the path, to anyone's path, to anyone's path. It's always the key. I don't care if you're a Sufi and you're twirling around, whatever. You're going for clarity of guru vision, right? So when that starts to arise, how do you deal with that? How do you It shocks you. It's stunning. It's amazing. It's so simple. Are you kidding me? Oh my gosh. This glimpsing at holy instant, you have to wow it. It's either that or you struggle with it. And when you struggle with it, you spiral down into concepts and labels and words and trying to explain to how do you keep your facade. You know, you try to reassemble your facade. Don't try to reassemble your facade. Okay, this is another way of looking at it. Very important, don't try to reassemble that facade. Just have faith that when you smooth it out and you get relaxed, that relaxedness will be your countenance. You know, you will feel, and it is, I'm getting more and more confident. There are times when the wow smooths out and I'm more relaxed, wow, I'm just like a world beater. I'm going down the road and I'm just clapping my hands and I'm, yes, 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 yes. I'm just like super confident. So this easement and super confidence emerges without you trying to do anything. You just have to be willing to drop your facade. Don't try to reassemble your facade. Be willing to do not try to reassemble your facade. Do not try to smooth out the ripples on the lake. Let them smooth out naturally. You just sit there quietly watching the ripples, or just don't have to watch them. Just say, I'm just going to sit here. And when it's smoothed out, it's smoothed out. I'll take whatever it turns out to be. Don't try to engineer any smoothing out. Don't try to be an architect or an engineer of assembling any sort of facade. You just say, my facade is gone. Whatever arises, this is what arises. And the gurus help us by showing us what arises is this easement, this super confidence of bliss, of peace of mind, of guru vision. This presence, that you know, this is what will arise, so, but that can never be manufactured. It's not something that's put together or built. It's the unbuilt facade. It's the facade of no facade. It will seem like a facade in this world, still, but it's the facade of no facade. It's a facade. Everything is already as it is. It's the non-facade of everything is already as it is. Just let that, this is what emerges. This is what will emerge. Trust it. As Ramana said, maybe the best quote ever, just trust it. Trust it. Keep satsang. Trust it. These little things, just trust it. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Being in the presence of those who have dropped all concepts, who have guru vision, being in the presence of those who have guru vision, have chosen guru vision, being in their presence, the satsang. It's just hearing this, just take that. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Trust it. You see, drugs, it's an excuse. Well, that's why the yoga girls will take drugs. Well, yeah, but the reason why I dropped my facade was I was on drugs, but normally I never lose my facade. I'm flawless. So it's kind of a way to have a cake and eat it too. The yoga girls say, yeah, I hate this facade. I hate it. But I don't dare drop it just under normal circumstances. So I'll get wasted and try to experience, the wow that way. But I know the drug will wear off and I'll be right back to my facade. So this is the bad way to go. Very bad. Very, very bad. And under no circumstances take drugs. This leads you to very conflicted mind, hideous, hideous existence. I mean, a lot of these yoga girls, gold diggers, they just hammer the alcohol or drugs. They just become alcoholics because the effort they're making to put on these airs and facades is so brutal. They just want to drop it and become a provincial again. And so the alcohol enables them to do this sort of and have an excuse for it. They can say to their boyfriend or friend or whatever, significant other, no, that's not really me. That was just alcohol talking, But they're really trying to get back to the way they used to be. I'm so tired of this gold digging. It's terrible. I hate it. But there's all that gold out there, So don't take drugs. Take satsang. Don't take drugs. Take satsang. I have a page now, a Facebook page, Take Satsang. You can look at facebook.com/, I don't know, what they don't give you exact, but Take Satsang. It's on my Facebook page. Under pages, I believe it should be there. Take Satsang. So I put all these pictures of those who have guru vision. So many pictures, so many, putting some few videos here. It's a way to hang out and look at these pictures. Just hang out, take satsang. It's super important. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Don't take medicine, take satsang. Let your facade crumble and don't try to reassemble it. Don't try to reassemble any facade. Now, of course, to the gold diggers is an anathema. Okay, but you're accepting you already have the gold. You don't need to dig for it. You already have it. Okay? Believe it. Trust this. This is true. None of us need to dig for it at all. We already have it. What are we doing digging for what we already have? What are we doing pursuing what we already have? This is absurdity. This is honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. We don't need to be gold diggers. We already have it. So we don't need any facade. No facade is needed. We already have it and we can't lose it. It's impossible to lose it. How can we lose intrinsic spaciousness? We already have it. We can't lose it. It's impossible. So we can just be natural and relax in easement, absolute easement. We don't need to pursue it. We don't need a facade, an image to pursue it, to trick it, do anything, deceive it, camouflage. No. We could just experience it directly. Guru vision, directly experienced. So each one of these videos is I don't know what's going to happen. I just go into the open mind. I'm just going to be wowed. I figure I'm just really going to be wowed. That's all. I don't know what I'm going to say. And it's always better than I expect. I don't have a script. Or what am I got to think? Okay, what am I? I just, okay, let me just wing it and do the best I can. And be sincere about it and be desperate about it. And this is what comes out. The desperation comes out. You know, the commitment and the desperation, I just let that produce the video. That's it. And this is what I advise everyone to have, this desperation and commitment and full stop on the wow. Again, no matter how you practice, anyone, ever, the goal is the dawning of guru vision. When that dawns, that's a wow. It's a huge, and how do you manage the wow? Full stop in the wow is the answer. Don't try to reassemble your image, facade. It feels terrible when you do that. Superficial, you plunge back into superficiality as if it's not already here. That you have to attain it, you have to pursue it, you have to trick it, you have to get it. No, it's already here. There's nothing we need to do to get it. We don't need to pursue what we already are, where we already are, what we already have. Who goes out and tries to pursue and earn what they already have? It's like someone's working. What are you working for? I got to get a car. Well, what about the red Ferrari in your driveway, brand new? Huh? Well, I got to earn that. No, you already have it. It's yours. You don't need to do anything to earn it. So why are you going out, spending your whole life pursuing it? You already have it. Who spends their whole life pursuing what they already have? Well, everybody in this world does that. Honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. Pursuing what you already have. Right? That's what we're doing. We're pursuing what we already have. That's honoring creativity in the lowest possible way. So we're just saying, okay, let's honor creativity by just accepting we already have. Non-pursuit. We already have what we already have. No need to pursue. That's medium honoring of creativity. Which is as far as anyone can go here, actually. Oh yeah, we're already there. I am as I am. Everything already is as it is. There's no need to pursue what's already present. So we already have the gold. No need to dig for it. Guru vision is just seeing what is. It's already seeing what is present right now. So why do we need to pursue that? Just see it. Not seeing it is trying to honor creativity in the lowest way. That's all it is. Just be aware, experience what's actually present, the intrinsic spaciousness of everything. And then, but again, wow it, the dawning of clarity, wow it, it will happen for you. When you're willing to wow it, it will automatically happen for you. You'll get an insight. You say, oh, I never saw that before. Oh my God, wow. Wow, that is super profound. I don't have to dig for the gold, it's already here. I don't have to chase what I already have. It's not running, it's not going anywhere. I'm not losing it anywhere. It's completely here all the time. There's absolutely nothing I need to do to grab a hold of it or grasp it or pursue it. I don't need to pursue it. I don't need to capture it. I don't need to lock it down. Nothing. I don't need to do anything. And when we are willing to recognize I don't need to do anything, then that it will dawn upon us. When we stop pursuing it, that's when we see it as it is. Because it's absurd to pursue what we already have, right? So as long as we're pursuing something, we're tacitly implying that it's not absurd. So it's kind of difficult to be pursuing something and still admit that you already have it. I mean, we'd say, well, what am I insane? You know, so kind of sort of relax the pursuit of it. Sit quietly. Don't pursue anything. Don't even pursue not pursuing. Forget the world. Forget the news. Forget the world. Forget everything. Forget enlightenment. Forget the pursuit of enlightenment. Forget attaining anything. Just realize we already have it. Just allow that. Accept that this is the truth. Everything already has it. Everything is just solid gold, actually. We are the gold. Why are we pursuing gold? We are gold. We are the gold. Everything is the gold of reality. So, I'm in the wow of doing this video, and I feel like, you know, kind of sluggish, and whew, how do I recover from this? Well, don't try to recover too fast. Don't pursue your recovery. See, don't even pursue your recovery of any facade. Just saying, whatever comes of this, I'll just allow the ripples to calm down, and we'll see how reflective the lake is, or how clear the lake is, or the pond. We'll see how clear the pond is. You know, and when it calms down, we may look in the pond and say, oh my gosh, so clear, it's unbelievably clear, wow. And there's another wow, and then more ripples in the pond. And we just do this over and over and over again. And then some point, we'll just recognize, hey, the pond also is intrinsic spaciousness. Everything is intrinsic spaciousness. There's nothing that is not. Guru vision. That's all it is, guru vision. Sort of a medium way of honoring creativity. Yeah, so just... We're getting close to the end, aren't we? Yes, we are. What is it saying? I can't read it, really. Okay, yeah. Got a few more moments here. So take all this to heart. Desperate commitment, dawning of clarity, be knocked out. Wow, don't try to reassemble your image or your facade. If you need to, don't go out. I mean, if you feel nervous about your image, just don't go out around people. Don't hang around people unless they don't care about your image. Everybody cares about functionality and image and everything. Just you know, be by yourself if you need to be by yourself. Pretty cool. I have such a lowly job. I really don't have to worry about image going out and everything. People just ignore me. So the guy's just a lowly, you know, slave. So, you know, what do I care about my image? It's actually useful. It's actually quite useful. Just a blue collar slave. And so, okay. Okay. They have a lousy image. That one, you know, well, They don't even have any hope to advance anyway, so, you know, it doesn't really matter for them. You know, poor son of a gun, but, oh well, what can you do? So it helps. I don't feel like I, you know, but still, we all feel we need to keep up appearances. So when you're really shocked by the wow, you know, just, you may just want to just sit there quietly for an hour or two, or just not do too much. I don't really feel, I feel kind of lackadaisical. I don't feel like doing a lot. I don't feel so motivated. I hardly do anything, really. Just kind of sit. I'll do graphics on the computer, and, you know, I don't feel like going out and going anywhere doing anything, really. Not much. I generally don't. I don't want to go to a restaurant, because then you got to around people, put up facades and stuff. I don't know, you got to admire their facades. No. I just want to sit here quietly. Just, wow, don't reassemble any facade. This is very, very profound. It's just shockingly profound. So I just want to feel the shock of this profundity. It's very cool. Feel the shock of profundity. Don't need drugs. Feel the shock of profundity. Don't take drugs, take satsang. It's very profound, very shocking. And it's very challenging too. And you feel a sense of accomplishment. Drugs, no sense of accomplishment, but drugs, are you kidding me? Here you feel a sense of accomplishment. Well, I'm really working out. This is a really intense workout. And you feel great after you do a workout, don't you? I did a lot of workout yesterday. I really did. I really hammered it. I felt like, wow, I really got after it. That is great. Today, haven't got after it yet, but we'll see. I might get after it again. Possible. Yeah. As you get, when you get after it, you feel a sense of accomplishment. Take drugs, you don't feel any sense of accomplishment. You feel stupid afterwards. So, don't take drugs, take satsang. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Make this your mantra. Believe in it and trust it. Trust it, trust it, trust it. And you will get confirmations, subtle confirmations, various ways that, yeah, this is the right thing to do. Don't take drugs, take satsang. Don't take drugs, take satsang. We're just about done now taking this satsang. So, great job, great job, great workout. Pat yourself on the back, take it easy. Just allow yourself to, you know, the ripples to just mellow out, and they'll gradually, the reverberations will gradually smooth out. Trust it. Just trust it.